Hello, Robert. Hello, Grant.
Hello, hello.
How you doing, man? How you doing?
How you doing? How you doing?
Hello.
How you doing?
Hello.
Hello. What's it like playing in Portugal and Lisbon? And if you have any recollections of past gigs?
Well, we were talking earlier about the Coliseum gigs in 2003, which were wicked. They were a great, great, great time there, because we stayed in Lisbon for a week and, you know, got to sort of explore the city a little bit. And the concerts were brilliant. I mean, you know, obviously we had the multimedia screen and everything was in Portuguese and it was really exciting. And I think before that we had a gig in the Expo in 99, which was really, really good fun. We did a gig with, I think, in a festival 2 years ago, which was okay, but it's a festival, you know, it's different. And this one today looks a little bit kind of, it's a little bit corporate by the looks of it, you know, a lot of people sponsoring it. If we'd probably been involved, we would have probably had a say in the lineup and created a proper sort of like a day. We did a show in London recently where we created a lineup for the whole day, and it was, you know, really eclectic. The Flaming Lips and Niles Barkley and Pharrell Williams, Damian Marley, Terry Kelly, DJ Shadow. It was a really, really great sort of like, you know, proper day out, wasn't it?
You know, festivals, it's kind of hard at festivals because you're not your own boss. You know, you're coming along to somebody else's show, and you know there's usually like maybe 5 or 10 acts, and you know people don't necessarily come along to see you. You know, so it's nice to do your own show, really.
Well, there's only 2 or 3 acts today. If they haven't come along to see us, we're really fucked.
Yeah, exactly.
By the way, what do you think of Hot Chip that they were playing earlier?
I've only heard one track, which my girlfriend plays over and over again. She fucking loves them, and she's got it on my iTunes. She sort of like downloaded it for me, but it's cool. You know, I mean, what were they like?
Alive, they weren't. You know, they were kind of tired because of, they played last night, and in a really steamy place. So, well, they were kind of calm.
Was it those MCs? Those guys in there?
Those were. Burak
sound system.
Yeah, they're a sound system.
Right. Because Hot Chip now, they're sort of hot. They're the hot shit at the moment.
Team.
Yeah, and sort of. In fact, I heard a remix that they did with Damon for the Gorillaz, you know. So they seem to be remixing quite a lot of stuff at the moment.
They're doing what we all did in the old days, is remixing to make your bucks in the Massive Attack and shit. We'd remix everyone. We were just like, we were real like prostitutes at the beginning. We remixed everyone that came along, didn't we? I mean, it's ridiculous. Yeah, we don't do anything there.
But at least you can use, you know, the things you've gained with that for, you know, good for a good cause now.
Well, no, because the thing is, the case that we were just now too expensive.
We practiced as at them. Also, things changed. You know, everyone was remixing from home on computers, and we were trying to ask, like, you know, I want 50 grand for that mix, mate. Right away. Well, we can get that guy down there to it for nothing. Oh shit. Okay. So it was like one of those ones where we actually kind of like didn't really predict the way things would change, even though we were watching it change ourselves by working on computers ourselves, you know. Now it's a different thing, man, remixing. Remixing was fun. I'll tell you what, the best thing about remixing was the fact you ended up writing about 5 tracks for yourself, because you sort of get this piece of music, you strip it back, create some new bits of music for it, and go, actually, that's too good, let's keep that. And then do another one, go, actually, that's wicked, let's keep that too. And then you finally give them the 5th thing you've done, and keep 4 other things to yourself, and then write new songs over them.
Have like, you know, hundreds of layers, and or not hundreds, but you know, many layers, and one of them are the original tracks, and then you strip the original tracks and go, wow, this is fantastic, I'll just keep this, I can understand.
Well, that's what we should do, yeah.
Or you do what Nelly and Jazzy used to do from Soul to Soul. You just dig up all their stuff and stick it under all the tracks underneath remixes, or all their own material. Just find the soundtrack from one of their records, just right, that fits, and stick it in.
No, it's fine. We do have more questions, you know.
How come you guys speak so good English? What's going on? You guys speak English like it's fucking natural.
You speak English better than English. So you speak English better than English?
No, I've been speaking English since I was 5, so...
That's mad, though. But I mean, you got every bit of vocabulary, you got all the vocab.
This is just me. Did you know Obelix?
Yeah,
Obelix from, you know, Asterix, a comic book. Yeah. He fell in the cauldron when he was...
yeah, exactly.
What happened to me?
But you, if you did, you go and see Getafix, right?
Possibly.
Getafix was the man who used to hand out the sort of the potion. I love that guy.
Yeah, exactly.
It's a great cartoon strip, Asterix, actually. Oh, in Brussels the other day, I stopped in Brussels in the airport, and they've got a magazine rack, and they've got like mags of rack, the usual shit, papers, magazines, but then they've got like two complete racks of like graphic novels. And they're completely obsessed with graphic novels. They've got all the Asterix novels, obviously. All the Tintin novels, obviously. But they've got tons and tons of really left field, like some Japanese, some European, Mobius, all kinds of really beautiful things. But I was checking, I mean, they're all beautifully drawn, but I think it's amazing that, you know, I don't know if it's in the, inherent in the whole country's culture, but a massive section of it where they love graphic novels and appreciate the art form, where you wouldn't find that in the UK. But it's just great. I mean, you don't see that in England. You know, you would get like, won't even get a comics rack anymore. Comics be relegated because of the kind of like the sort of Heat magazines and the celeb magazines, and you know, all the kind of like soap magazines, all those things are now completely taken over the racking of the shelves. And when I was a kid, I used to go into a shop with comics at the bottom, porn at the top, do you know what I mean? And maybe in the middle you get motors and cars and maybe Woman's Own, you know, and sort of recipe books and stuff. And now it's just like celeb, TV, and you might get nothing else. What's involved? Because it keeps everyone happy and controlled, doesn't it? You know, the problem is the Big Brother thing. Well, the whole film is women that do it all. Women are the people who vote, because women get a sense of control out of it. Because they feel they're in control of the situation. And they feel they're in control of their relationship, so they can vote on Big Brother. So 70% of women in the UK are the people who vote for Big Brother. It's only a small percentage of men. I knew that from the start, because men can't be fucked with that. And they ought to get up and vote for Big Brother. It's very much women. Women that buy those magazines, and women that vote for that stuff.
Men vote for Rooney if he was well sent off or badly sent off, you know, in the World Cup.
Exactly, we're sports freaks, and so we have our own drugs, don't we? Our own sedatives, is you know, the World Cup's a sedative of sorts, although it seems to have made a lot of people angry rather than happy, do you know what I mean, or very unrelaxed in general.
Guys, just before we go, we kind of have to, you know, ask you about the new album. What's coming up? Could you tell, you know, the fans want to know and stuff?
We don't even know what's coming up, to be honest. We're just in the process of experimenting and getting some tracks together and stuff like that, and it's in its embryonic stage.
Still a bit off. It's still happening in the, not in the near future.
It's most, we don't want to rush. I mean, the thing is with records is at some point you say to yourself and you say to other people, oh yeah, it's really getting together, it's really there, and we really can see a deadline for it, we can see we're going to release it then. But then when you actually sort of sit down and think about the responsibilities you have to what you want to do and what you should do, what you've done in the past, and you want to make it extra special, then you think, wait a minute, no, it's going to take more time. And we're never going to put something out unless it's ready for whatever reason, you know.